We're going to look at how to calculate bad debt expense using the allowance methods. GAAP requires us to estimate bad debt in order to properly match expenses of the period to the revenues of the period. Okay, now there's two different methods we can use. Both are acceptable. We have the percentage of sales method, which is on the left side of the board, and we have the percentage of accounts receivable method, sometimes called an analysis of receivables, on the right side of the board. Now these are going to be on two different videos, but I'm going to be comparing the two in the second video. So bear that in mind as you're watching this first video on the percentage of sales method. That's what we're going to be focusing on here. Now in this example, my revenue for the year was $3 million, and we estimate that the uncollectible percentage of sales is 2%, which would be $60,000. Okay, 2% or $60,000. Now with the sales method, we multiply sales of 3 million times 2%, we get $60,000. That's the adjusting journal entry right there. So I'm simply gonna debit bad debt expense, and I'm gonna credit the allowance for bad debt. The sales method focuses on the income statement. We're taking revenue and we're trying to calculate how much should bad debt expense be on the income statement. We're not really focusing on the balance sheet with the percentage of sales method. Now notice, in the first example, we assume that the allowance for bad debt has a $1,000 credit balance. Let's backtrack just a little bit. On the balance sheet, we have to show accounts receivable at net realizable value. That is, total accounts receivable minus the allowance for bad debt, or the allowance for doubtful accounts, equals net accounts receivable. I like to think of it this way. Total AR minus the bad receivables equals the good receivables, what we think we're going to collect. In the first example, we assume that we have this leftover or remaining balance in the allowance before we make the current year adjusting entry. This year's adjusting entry, using the sales method, 3 million times 2%, 60,000, I debit bad debt expense, which goes on the income statement, and I'm going to credit the allowance. And notice that's going to leave a $61,000 credit balance in the allowance, and that's what we're going to report on the balance sheet. Okay? In example two, the allowance has a debit balance before adjustment. This is that leftover or remaining balance. Again, we multiply sales times the 2%, $60,000. Again, since we're focusing on the income statement, that's how much I think bad debt expense should be. My adjusting entry, debit bad debt expense, credit the allowance for bad debt. Remember, the allowance is a contra asset, which has a normal credit balance. So now I'm going to credit the allowance, just like I did in the first example, but notice that the ending balance in the allowance is a little bit different. And that's again because we're focusing on measuring the expense on the income statement, bad debt expense, and we're not really focusing on what the value for accounts receivable should be. Okay, what we see is that the sales method, we call it, has an income statement of focus, and the accounts receivable method, which we're going to see next, has more of a focus on the balance sheet. So, the sales method, we simply multiply sales times a percentage. That gives us bad debt expense. Notice that's the adjusting entry, regardless of if I had a credit balance or a debit balance remaining in the allowance. The bad debt expense will be the same on the income statement. However, the ending balance in the allowance account, again, which goes on the balance sheet, will be slightly different if I have a credit balance versus a debit balance.